So thank you for coming back. If you really made it through that entire last video, here we are again, and we're going to take a big leap now. We're going to do something even more exciting than we thought was even ever possible in the previous video. Okay, so here I am. I got to get myself situated here. What do we got? We got a processing sketch with a variable declared at the top. It's given an initial value 50, and now we're drawing that circle at 50, 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 right? Forever and ever go. That's why that circle's always there. We now want to move that circle. We need a new assignment operation. We have an assignment operation that's in setup that's giving it its initial value. Now we need an assignment operation in draw. Move the circle one pixel, right? If the circle was at pixel 50, move it to 51. If it's at 51, move it to 52, right? Increment the circle's x location by one. How are we going to write that code? How are we going to write that code? Okay. We're thinking. By the way, one of the most relaxing activities you can do in your life is, it's a little better when you're by yourself, not recording a video. It's just quietly and like thoroughly clean a whiteboard. Anyway, okay, so we have draw. It's looping over and over again. Run this code, go back to the beginning, run this code, and we have this circle that is right now being drawn at pixel location 50, which is the value of circle x. What we want to do is we want to say, hey, every time through draw, let's give circle x a new value. What should its new value be? It should be its current value plus one. Now, this assignment operation, this expression might look a little strange to you, almost as if it's some sort of weird paradox. Like, no, nothing can equal itself plus one. That doesn't make any sense. But we have to remember what an assignment operation does is evaluate the right side of an equation. This pen is squeaking like crazy. Do I have another one? I had another one. Oh, here we go. Is evaluate the right-hand side of the equation and take the result of that value, much better, and store it in the left-hand side. So if circle x currently has the value of 50, we evaluate 50 plus 1, which becomes 51, and then that gets stored, and circle x is now 51. And if what's happening in that beginning of draw, we're drawing an ellipse at circle x, then we come back here and draw it at 51. Then 51 plus 1 is 52. Then we come back here and draw it at 52. Then increment that by 1. This is the process. This is the type of thing. This is like such a simple little like basic scenario. All it's doing is moving a circle left or right. But this is the foundation of everything you might ever possibly want to do. It's coming up with an algorithm. What is the logic behind what I'm doing and implementing that through code? So let's take a look at adding this into our program. So where are we going to do that? So we could say, like, oh, should I put it up here? Maybe I should put it at the bottom. It actually, in many ways, doesn't really matter. One thing that I often like to do is separate out. We can say, like, this is my drawing stuff, and this is my like logical manipulation of, I don't know what, like moving variables. I don't know what I'm saying. I really had an idea here. But drawing stuff plus, I'll just have kind of like logic over here. We'll just call it logic for a second. You don't have to separate this, but I'm going to do that just for kind of keeping our code nice and clean. So I'm going to say circle x equals circle x plus 1, semicolon. We're going to run it. And look, there it is. The circle's moving so nice and lovely. Good-hello, goodbye. It's going to leave. It's going to be sad because, you know, it's plus one, plus one, plus one, and plus one. It's still actually incrementing over and over again, going further and further. So processing, by the way, it doesn't matter. You can tell it to draw something at a pixel value that is not within the window. You won't see it appear. It's not like suddenly appearing over here in our computer screen, but it is sort of being done in the sort of mind of processing. So we can see, look at this, circle x equals circle x plus one. We did it. Now we have animation. Okay, so there are a few additional items here that I want to discuss. Number one is, what if we wanted to go twice as fast? That's pretty easy. Circle x equals circle x plus two. Let's move 2 pixels every frame. What if we wanted to go 10 times as fast? Circle x equals circle x plus 10. Now we're going 10 pixels per frame. We can see it zoomed right off the screen. What if we wanted to go half as fast? Okay, circle x equals circle x plus 1. What is half of 1? 0.5. We run this and okay, look at this. Look at that message. Cannot convert from float to int. This is what we mean by using a strictly typed language. All of a sudden, we introduced a floating point value, 0.5, a decimal number, but yet we declared our variable a type integer. And an integer cannot be 1.5, 2, 2.5. However, we can make this work by changing the value of circle x to a float. Now, you might just suddenly feel like, awesome, dive right in, run it, let's do it. But if you really think about this for a moment, you're going to start to think like something is horribly wrong here. What's happening? I mean, I have a window in the computer. There is a window in the computer. And we said, I can draw something at like pixel 50, 180. Right? And we put our circle there, and there it is. Pixel 50, 180. What if I said to you, draw this circle at pixel 50.5, 180? Well, you would say like, no, absolutely not. I shall do no such thing. There's no such thing as pixel 50.5. There's pixel 50 and there's pixel 51, but there's no pixel 50.5. Right? I counted those pixels on the screen there. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, right? But here's the thing. Even though there is technically no pixel 50.5, pixel 50.8, processing allows you to use floating point values when you want to draw something in the window, and what it does secretly is it just lops off the decimal point. So if you ask to draw something at 50.5, you will get it at really at pixel 50. Now, why is this so useful? Let's think about this idea of a circle moving quickly or slowly. Okay? These could be its values every frame. Pixel 50, pixel 51, 52, 53, 54, 55, right? If we wanted to move faster, 50, then 55, then 60, then 65, right? Move 5 pixels per frame. But what if we do this? 50, 50.5, 51, 51.5, 52, 52.5, right? It won't actually be drawing the circle at pixel 50.5. It will just draw it at the pixel 50 twice. But if it's running 30 frames per second and we draw it at the same location twice, it's going to appear as if it's moving more slowly. Now, we could implement all sorts of crazy logic. We could try to sort of change. There's a function processing called frame rate, which will actually slow the frame rate of the entire application down. But this is not what we want. What if we want one thing moving really fast and one thing moving really slow? We need to manipulate the locations and sizes of things using floating points. Allows us to have more precision over the speed and kind of the nuance of how things happen visually in our program. So that was kind of like a long explanation, but what I'm saying with that is that I would suggest to you right now that for the time being, just use a float for everything. There are cases where you absolutely want a whole number, but in the case of drawing a pixel of drawing shapes at locations, drawing sizes of shapes, manipulating those sizes, we really want to use floats. And let's take a look at that now over here. So once we have a float and I run it, we can see that's moving half as fast. And if I say, 0.1, it's really moving really slowly, but it's moving. But you can't tell that it's really sitting at the same, if you kind of like look at it really, really carefully, maybe you can, but the frame rate is fast enough that it just looks like it's inching its way along, and you can even do stuff like I'm kind of going crazy here, 0.01, we can say like, okay, it's moving, but it's moving so slowly we can barely perceive it. So, but if we went, if I went to like take a walk around outside for a little bit, clear my head, come back, it'd probably be quite a bit further along on the screen. Okay, so floating points allow you to do a lot. Okay, this is a good place to stop. We've done quite a bit here, even though it seems like we've barely done anything. We just have this little circle moving. What I would say to you right now is go to your sketch. You have variables you declare at the top, make them floats. Give all those variables initial values, and then try manipulating those values. Can you make something grow? Can you make something shrink? Can you make something change color? what can you do with variables at this point? In the next video, we're going to look at how we can actually give things random values to create a certain additional variation in our programs. And then, of course, at some point in the next set of videos, we need to figure out how to get this thing to turn around when it hits the edge, right? How do we have a condition into our code? How do we say if that circle reaches the edge, turn around and move the other way, right? Instead of saying circle x plus 1, now say circle x minus 1. How do we make that happen? That's where we're going towards here. But at first, we just want to get used to having variables, storing data, and that sort of thing. Okay. Actually, hello. What I forgot to say was a simple exercise you might do with this is just add the y component to it, right? Take this program, add circle y, give circle y an initial value, and give circle y an initial speed as well. Increment circle y by some value and see if you can get it to move in addition to the x-axis along the y-axis.